Hello everyone and welcome to Boundless Dentistry. In this video we'll talk about how do we manage crossbite. First we'll start off with some basic facts that are related to crossbite, then talking about different causes that lead to crossbite, and then moving towards the main objective of our video, that is how do we manage crossbite. So let's get started. Firstly, talking about what basically is crossbite. The definition of crossbite is abnormal labiolingual or buccolingual relation. Now, what do we mean by that? So for that, we have to first know what's the normal relation of the occlusion. In this picture, you can see that this is your maxillary molar and this is your mandibular molar. If you close your mouth in full intercuspation, that is, you are occluding your teeth completely, you can feel that the maxillary molar is present in front of your mandibular molar. So this is your normal occlusion, that is how it should be. But when we talk about crossbite, this normal relation is not present. So in this picture on your right hand side, you can see that the mandibular molar is now present ahead of this maxillary molar. The maxillary molar's buccal cusp is occluding in the mandibular fossa of the lower molar instead of the palatal cusp, which should occlude in the mandibular molar's central fossa. So the relation is reversed. This is known as crossbite. A different variation of crossbite is that the maxillary molar is present completely buccal to the mandibular molar. This is also crossbite. So by crossbite, we simply mean that the abnormal labiolingual or buccolingual relation is present. Now, crossbite can either be related to one single teeth or a segment of teeth, and crossbite can either be unilateral or bilateral. By unilateral, we mean that the crossbite is present on one side of your teeth, and bilateral means it's present in both sides of your teeth. Crossbite can also be either anteriorly or posteriorly. Anteriorly, it involves your incisors and canines, and posteriorly, it can involve your premolars and molars. For anterior crossbite, you can see this lower picture that normally your maxillary incisor is present ahead of your mandibular incisor. But when crossbite occurs, the relation is reversed. The mandibular incisor is present in front of this maxillary incisor. So this is anterior crossbite. Now there are different crossbite which can either originate from any abnormality in your skeletal, which by skeletal we mean that there is something wrong with maxilla or mandible. Either the maxilla is small or the mandible is large, which can lead to skeletal crossbite. By dental crossbite, we simply mean that your mandible and maxilla are alright, they are fine, but something is wrong with your teeth. For example, they are erupting in a more palatal direction or in a buccal direction, so this can lead to crossbite. So maxilla and mandible are absolutely fine, but something is wrong with your teeth. And thirdly, by functional crossbite, we mean that when you're closing your jaw, it is deviating from your normal occlusion pattern. This can be due to any occlusal discrepancy which is present in your mandible. For example, one of your molar is in hyperocclusion. When it's hyperocclusion, for example, in right hand side, your mandible tends to deviate in the opposite direction so that proper closure can occur. So in functional crossbite, there is some problem with your pattern of jaw closure. So these are the three type of crossbite, and this basically defines the etiology, because in skeletal something is wrong with the maxilla mandible, in dental crossbite something is wrong with your teeth but mandible and maxilla is alright, and functional crossbite there is something wrong with your pattern of jaw closure. Now the posterior crossbite can also be further classified into two different types. First we have buccal non-occlusion, then we have lingual non-occlusion. Firstly, talking about buccal non-occlusion, in this buccal non-occlusion, we simply mean that in this diagram on your right hand side, you can see this is your maxillary molar and this is your mandibular molar. You can see how buccally this maxillary molar is placed as compared to your mandibular molar. So the buccal positioning of this maxillary molar leads to the term buccal non-occlusion, because it's present so buccally and there will be trouble in when patient is occluding. So this is known as buccal non-occlusion. On the other hand, talking about lingual non-occlusion, in this case you can see this maxillary molar is present lingually as compared to your mandibular molar. So the lingual placement of this maxillary molar gives rise to the term lingual non-occlusion. Now talking about the different etiologies that lead to crossbite, we'll talk about the most common ones, starting with your size of your jaw. For example, like we have discussed before, if your maxilla is small or your mandible is large, there will be some crossbite, because if for example your maxilla is small and your mandible is large, the crossbite will occur because the positioning of the jaw has changed. So this is the first and the most common cause which is can lead to crossbite. The second cause is sometimes your deciduous teeth are retained. For example, your molars are ankylosed. So when they are retained, the positioning of the permanent toothbrush, which is coming from below, it is deflected, and when it's deflected, it can either erupt buccally or palatally. When it does, the relation of the molars is changed or incisors is changed. So this will also tend to lead to crossbite. Thirdly, and importantly, mostly in children, the abnormal habits can also lead to crossbite. For example, thumb sucking habit up till 3 years of age is normal, but after that, even mouth breathing, it's normal up till that. But if it exceeds this time period, this can lead to crossbite, because when you're sucking your thumb, the buccinator muscle in your chin, in your cheeks, they are exerting pressure on your maxillary arch. So when they exert pressure on your maxillary arch, your maxilla will tend to constrict transversely and the mandible is unopposed. So when maxilla constricts transversely, so the size of your maxilla will be small as compared to the mandible, and that will lead to crossbite. Similarly, this can also be seen with mouth breathing, which will lead to crossbite. And lastly, there are some congenital causes, for example, cleft palate, because in cleft palate there is space in your cleft, and when that is present, the teeth erupt in a malocluded pattern. So when that happens, that can also lead to crossbite. Now, when talking about correcting anterior crossbite, some important factors has to be noted. Firstly, we'll talk about overbite. Now, when you have corrected crossbite, developing overbite is very important, and that is because you can see in this diagram, if this overbite was not present, this is your maxillary incisor, this is your mandibular incisor. If this overbite was not present, the vertical overlap between your both incisors, the maxillary incisor would tend to move backwards. The before picture, when the patient came to you for correction of crossbite, there can be a relapse by the backward movement of this maxillary incisor. So when you have corrected anterior crossbite, the development of this overbite is very important. Secondly, so sometimes the patient, when the crossbite has been corrected, open bite develops. So when that open bite develops, the chances of relapse occurs, because as we have talked before, this overbite is important. So when open bite develops, it's important to correct the open bite, and the open bite is corrected by extrusion of the teeth. Extrusion means hyper occluding the teeth so that overbite can develop. And thirdly, the overbite and presence of deep bite, when these two conditions are present, we place a posterior bite block, which helps in treatment plan of the anterior crossbite. Now, the second factor that has to be considered when we are planning the treatment for anterior crossbite, that is presence of space. Now, it's very well understood that if space will be present, only then the teeth can be either positioned buccally or lingually if you are trying to achieve normal occlusion. And if there is no proper space present, there will be trouble when we are trying to reposition the teeth, because there is no space. So how will the teeth move in its proper place? So presence of space is very important. And if proper space is present, we can use removable appliance along with finger spring. In this picture, you can see on your right hand side that this is your finger spring appliance, and you can see some space is available. So we can use this appliance to move this teeth particular in the buccal direction to achieve normal occlusion. Also, we can use some fixed appliance along with coil spring, but the only condition here is that some space should be available so that teeth can move in its proper position. The third factor that has to be considered is that when we are planning treatment, is that whether the tipping movement of the teeth has to occur or bodily movement has to occur. By tipping movement, you can see in this picture on your left hand side, by tipping, the tooth is in its normal position, only the position of your crown is changing. You can see that the root is not moving anywhere, only the crown is moving. The root is present at its respective position. So when we are planning to achieve tipping movement of your teeth, we use removable appliance. And on the other hand, when bodily movements are to occur, by bodily movements we mean that the whole teeth along with the root is moving in either buccal, lingual, mesial, distal, whatever direction the dental surgeon requires the whole teeth, the whole root and crown are moving in some direction. And when that bodily movement is required, we used fixed appliance. And the fourth factor that has to be considered is functional shift on closure. By functional shift, we simply mean that we ask the patient to open his or her mouth, and then we check for midline, and then we ask the patient to close the mouth. And if there is any change in midline on closure, we can suspect that there is some functional cause that is leading to the crossbite. And the final factor that has to be considered when treating anterior crossbite is that the number of teeth that has to be corrected. If one or two teeth are being corrected in the normal occlusion, we can use normal removal appliance. But if more than 2, 3, 4, 5 whole segment is required for correction, then we prefer fixed appliance. Now moving towards the main objective of our video, that is how do we correct crossbite. So first we'll talk about the treatment options that are available to correct anterior crossbite, and then in this we'll first focus on removable appliances. And in removable appliances, the first that we have is tongue blade. Now what do we mean by tongue blade? A tongue blade is a wooden stick like appliance that is used mainly to correct the positioning of a single tooth. You can see in this picture the wooden like stick is inserted in your mouth and it's placed against that tooth that has to be corrected. So when you place this wooden stick palatally, some pressure is exerted in this direction, buccal direction, and this is done for 1 to 2 hours for 2 weeks. And in this case you can see how pressure is exerted for 1 to 2 hours for 2 weeks, and some repositioning of this tooth can occur. But the condition in this case is it can only help in one or two teeth. You cannot use this appliance to correct a whole segment of your arch. The second removable appliance used for anterior crossbite is Catalan's appliance. In Catalan's appliance, you can see this acrylic appliance that has been constructed at an angle of 45 degrees. When this is constructed at an angle of 45 degrees, some labial force will occur, and when the labial force will occur, it will lead to labially positioning of that teeth. So this can be used to correct the crossbite. But the same condition is that only one or two teeth can be used, because as we have discussed before, removal appliances are only used when one or two teeth require correction. The third removal appliance that can be used is double cantilever spring, which is known as commonly Z-spring. You can see the shape of this appliance is somewhat resembling a Z. So this is known as Z-spring, and it is used for correction of one or two maxillary teeth, because that is the whole point of using removal appliance, for correction of one or two teeth. And one important condition when using the Z-spring is that some adequate space has to be available so that this palatally placed teeth can be moved in a buccal direction. And you can see in this picture that some space is available, so this appliance is suitable in this case, and the teeth can move in a buccal direction, so Z-spring can be used. But there are different appliances, like we have discussed these three appliances that are used in correction of anterior crossbite. These removal appliances, it depends on patient to patient. In some patients we can use Catalan's appliance, in some patients we can use tongue blade, and in some cases you can use Z-spring. So it depends on what condition you have in front of your eyes. Now moving on towards the fixed appliances that are used for anterior crossbite correction. Fixed appliances are mainly used when there's excessive crowding is present, and when some extrusion of teeth is required, because when extrusion will be performed, only then teeth can move in the labial direction that we'll discuss just shortly right now. The first appliance that is used is lower posterior bite plane. In this picture you can see, and I have drawn it right over here, this is your mandibular incisor and this is your maxillary incisor. Now we have to perform this movement, labial movement, but you can see that there is some overlap over here, and when there is some overlap present over here, it's very obvious that the maxillary incisor cannot move, because it will hit this mandibular incisor. So in order to achieve some space so that the maxillary incisor can move in a labial direction, we use lower posterior bite plane. And you can see this is the scenario that I just discussed with you, and it is known as locked bite, because the incisor cannot move in a labial direction. So we place this lower posterior bite plane over here, and when we do so, you can see now there is some space, so this maxillary incisor can now move in a labial direction. And when this appliance is used, after some weeks and months, you can see the normal occlusion has been achieved, thereby eliminating crossbite. This is the diagram which I have drawn for you guys when lower posterior bite has plane has been used, and you can see the space that has been created, and now this maxillary incisor can move in a labial direction. Also, instead of using lower posterior bile plane, we can also apply some GIC over here on this first molar. And when we apply GIC, the mechanism of action is similar as we have discussed for lower posterior bite. The main purpose that of using this is to create some space to achieve this relation for the movement of this teeth in a labial direction. Now moving on towards correction of posterior crossbite, because crossbite are of two types. Sometimes it occurs anteriorly, sometimes it occurs posteriorly. So far we have discussed how anterior crossbite is treated. Now we'll divert our attention towards how posterior crossbite is treated. Now the first appliance that can be used to correct posterior crossbite is crossbite elastics. In this picture, this clinical picture, you can see this elastic like appliance is used. Now how is this elastic like appliance used? The one end of this elastic is inserted at your palatal end of your maxillary molar, and the other end is inserted over here, which is your buccal surface of your mandibular molar. And when this appliance is used, some buccal force is exerted, and when this buccal force is exerted, the teeth moves in a buccal direction, and which can help in correction of your crossbite. The max duration which this crossbite elastic should be used is 6 weeks, because if it's used more than that, some extrusion of the teeth will occur, and that will be further detrimental for the already patient suffering from crossbite. The second appliance that can be used is a removal appliance that is known as coffin spring. And in this diagram, you can see how this coffin spring is placed over here, and maybe it somewhat looks like a coffin, so thereby giving it the name coffin spring. But anyhow, this coffin spring is used for dentoalveolar expansion. By dentoalveolar expansion, we mean that the teeth and this palate, it expands in this direction, and mostly the teeth expand in this direction, not so much as a palate, because it depends when we are using it, either in the young generation or in the older generation. So mainly the teeth expand, and when they expand, they move in a buccal direction, and thereby some expansion does occur, so it can help in correction of your crossbite. And this coffin spring is manually activated. We take this appliance out, we move it in the buccal direction 1 to 2 mm per week, and when we do so, force exerts in this buccal direction, and this posterior crossbite can be corrected by using this coffin spring. The third appliance that can be used is known as quad helix. Quad helix can also be used in adjunct to fixed appliance. But focusing on quad flex is a spring-like appliance. You can see over here, these are 1, 2, 3, 4 quad, and these are resembling like helices, so these are known as quad helix. And what is the purpose of creating such helices? The purpose is so that range of action can occur and the flexibility of this appliance is present. And when this range of action can be taken place and flexibility is present, we can use it for our purpose of expansion, and that is the main purpose of using, for so that expansion can occur and crossbite can be corrected. Mostly you can see this quad helix, this is banded over your molars so that some retention can occur, and then this force is exerted in this buccal direction so that some expansion can occur. And in some cases, when used in young patients, some skeletal expansion can also occur because of the presence of midline palatal suture. So if used in young generation, some expansion of your palate can also occur, but not in older adults because the suture is closed. The fourth appliance that can be used is Hyrex appliance. And Hyrex appliance is used when rapid maxillary expansion is required. And what do we mean by that? You can see in this picture, this is your Hyrex appliance. And in the center, this is a jackscrew, and the appliance is banded over your molar. And when this jackscrew is activated, for example, 1 mm, 2 mm, whatever the dentist feels is right, the jackscrew is activated. And when it's activated, forces occur in the buccal direction. And when the forces occur in the buccal direction, it leads to correction of your crossbite. So there are certain indications of when to use Hyrex appliance. For example, bilateral crossbite is present, crossbite present over here, and crossbite present over here as well. Sometimes patient present with deep bite. In this patient, we can also use this appliance. And in some patients, even nasal obstruction is present, because when there is nasal obstruction present, it will lead to mouth breathing of that patient. And when mouth breathing is present, it will lead to crossbite like we have discussed before. So in that patient, we can also use Hyrex appliance. And lastly, we have a fixed appliance which can be used for correction of posterior crossbite, that is Wilson's or W arch appliance. It is mainly used for expansion of your arch. You can see this appliance forces occur in a buccal direction. These bands are placed over your molars. It was initially used mainly for cleft palate patients because in that patient's crossbite is present. But normally, patients without cleft palate can also be treated with this W arch appliance for correction of your crossbite by providing some forces for expansion of your arch. So in this video, we focused on what is crossbite. We talked in detail about how different type of crossbites are present: unilateral, bilateral, anterior crossbite, posterior crossbite. Then we moved on towards talking about different etiologies that lead to crossbite, and then we started off with the main objective of the video, that was how do we treat crossbite, either anterior crossbite treatment or posterior crossbite treatment, and how and when do you use removal appliances and fixed appliance. So I hope this video was useful for you, and if you like this video, please like, share, subscribe, and press the bell icon. Thank you for watching this video.